I am Blake Papsin. I've been doing bone conduction devices since the mid-90s when I learned about this technique when I was training in England. For this device, this is the first time I've actually seen a bone conduction device which would allow me to do what I do in the laboratory, which is study the development of the auditory system, because this thing has such natural and high-frequency access that it really seems to be a device that allows us to get into the subtleties of auditory development, which for me is the most exciting thing about it. So I hear from the audiologists and I hear from the parents that they're wearing it all the time, and that this concept of naturalness is what sort of resonates with me. They just say it sounds like normal hearing. It sounds much better than anything I've ever had before, and even though the trial was for unilateral, I have a significant number of children who are asking for a second one, which they had never asked for, with sometimes up to 15 years of experience with a Connect system unilaterally. They were waiting for something better on the other side. So I've actually converted at least one of them to a bilateral candidate and recipient now, and that's where I'm getting a lot of this very interesting bilateral data that shows that the auditory system is actually capable of processing these two devices separately and combining the input from two sides as sort of fusing the information in true binaural fashion. The difference between Osia and other bone conduction systems is not something that I could really, really ever give you an answer to, because in truth, it's the customer's experience that really is most important. So I'll tell you what the customers say, is that they say this is the most natural sound that they've ever heard. Some have had a Connect system for a long time. One of the complications that I got in the early phase of the study was that this one child, a teenager, wouldn't take it off at night because they loved the sound so much. Now, that's sort of funny, and of course we counseled them not to do that, but the interesting thing is that this is natural sound, and this is sound that has access to ultra-high frequencies that makes the components of speech and language and life that we find so appealing for the first time perceptible and possible. Surgically, it's a fairly straightforward procedure. Technically, the device we know from the devices that preceded it is reliable and effective and has Bluetooth and good microphones and good processing. So it's really hard for me to say this is a better device, but I for a number of reasons, I think that that is in fact the case. Interestingly, when you ask me about what have I learned from Osia, I think what I've learned so far, surgically at least, is that this is a technique that has to be done sort of according to the manual, according to the formula. There are so many areas, subtleties, where a slight error can really end in a poor outcome. For example, if you're at surgery and you realize you want to move the device a couple of millimeters, what you can't do is you can't move the incision. It's already been done. And then at closure, you're going to find you have difficulty because this thing is slightly protruding. This is a beautiful device, but it can leave you, I predict, looking rather foolish if you don't make every effort to stay on your plan. Thank you.